So many supposedly credible sources of health information repeatedly insist that carbohydrates are an essential part of the human diet, and they're all wrong. We must address this misinformation because many people can benefit from low or very low carb diets. Those people shouldn't be discouraged because they think they're missing out on something they need. In this video, I will explain why the answer to this question should be a flat no. So let's get started. Hi Carb Dodgers, I'm Dr. Dan Maggs. I'm so glad you've landed on my channel, which is about achieving lasting weight loss through low carb, real food nutrition. If that sounds like something you'd be interested in, then make sure you're subscribed to my channel so you get notified whenever I upload new videos. So why do these people think we need carbs? The main reason given is that we need carbs for energy. But there are a few other points people raise too, like we need carbs for thyroid function and gut health, and because of all the other nutrients that come along with carbohydrate-based foods. I'm going to be addressing all of these in this video, but first, let's get clear on the question. Do we need carbs? Let's briefly clarify what we mean when talking about carbohydrates, or carbs for short. Carbohydrates are the sugars, starches, and fibers found in our foods. There are three single sugars: glucose, sometimes known as the blood sugar, fructose, sometimes called the fruit sugar, and galactose. Galactose is quickly converted into glucose, so we can think of it as glucose. We've got some double sugars. Sucrose, better known as table sugar, is glucose and fructose joined together, and that gets quickly broken down when we consume it. And lactose, the milk sugar, is glucose and galactose. So it all ends up as glucose. Then there are starches. Starches are long chains of glucose molecules linked together. It's how plants store glucose. Bread, rice, pasta, and potatoes are examples of foods that contain starches. These chains all get broken down once they're digested, and so it all ends up as glucose. So I find it's really helpful to think of starches as just concentrated glucose. Finally, we have fiber. Fibers are also linked chains of glucose, however, we cannot digest these due to the slightly different way they're linked together. Typically, fiber comes from the cell walls of plants, called cellulose. Some animals, such as cows, can break down these cell walls for nutrition. We call these animals ruminants. So now we're all clear on what carbs are, let's look at the other part of the question. Do we need carbs? To need something implies that it's necessary, that it's required because it's essential. For example, we need to breathe air and we need to drink water. To need something is not the same as it being either important, desirable, or nice to have. In the world of nutrition, we have what are known as essential nutrients. These are nutrients that we must consume in sufficient quantities to remain healthy. Put another way, insufficient amounts of essential nutrients cause disease. You'll be familiar with some of these deficiency diseases. A lack of iron causes iron deficiency anemia. A lack of B12 also causes anemia, but can also cause neurological problems. Iodine deficiency causes thyroid problems, which is why many countries put iodine in salt. And I'm sure you all learned in school that a lack of vitamin C causes scurvy, the scourge of sailors for thousands of years. These are all examples of micronutrient deficiencies, and micronutrients are the vitamins and minerals that we only need in relatively small amounts. But we do need them. They are essential nutrients. But we can also have macronutrient deficiencies. The three main macronutrients are proteins, fats, and carbohydrates. We need protein. Specifically, we need certain amino acids, which are the building blocks of proteins. 20 amino acids make up the proteins in human bodies, of which we need to consume 9 of these. They are therefore termed essential amino acids. We can make non-essential amino acids in our bodies and don't need to consume them. Mild protein deficiency leads to muscle wasting, brittle bones, and a reduced ability to fight infections. Severe protein deficiency is rare in the Western world, but sadly common in developing countries and presents as diseases called marasmus and kwashiorkor. We can become deficient in fats too. We need to consume both omega-3 and omega-6 fatty acids. Fats, therefore, are essential. People with fatty acid deficiency develop fatigue, poor memory, dry skin, heart problems, mood issues, and poor circulation. Deficiency is rare, but it can occur in medical conditions that stop people from absorbing fats. It can also occur in those following extremely fat-restricted diets. So that brings us to the final macronutrient, carbohydrates. There's no such thing as carbohydrate deficiency. Other than a few transitional symptoms when we first eliminate carbohydrates, no long-term deficiency illnesses result from carbohydrate elimination or restriction. Therefore, we don't need carbohydrates. It's as simple as that. So why do people think that carbs are essential? Well, there are several common reasons that people give. We need carbs to provide our bodies with energy is the most common mistake that I see reported. No, we don't need carbohydrates for energy. People who tell us this have an incomplete understanding of metabolism. The absence of carbohydrates usually occurs in two ways: fasting and starvation, or by eliminating carbohydrates from the diet, pretty much just consuming fish, eggs, and meat, what some people call a carnivore diet. And it's important to understand what happens when we stop eating carbohydrates. Firstly, we start burning more fat. We're always told that fat is very high in calories. It's one of the nonsense arguments people use to explain why eating fat is bad. But by the same logic, that makes it an excellent fuel source for our bodies, especially for those of us who are carrying around a bit extra. When we reduce or eliminate carbohydrates from our diets, we also reduce the production of insulin, our fat storage hormone. This low insulin state creates the ideal metabolic conditions for us to burn fat as fuel. Most of the tissues in the body can burn fat for fuel, with the brain being the major exception to this. Next, we start producing ketones. Ketones are an alternative energy source produced in the liver, either from fat we consume or fat that we've got stored. Ketones indeed are an excellent source of energy for the brain. They're also a cleaner burning fuel, producing fewer free radicals than when we burn glucose. Now, fats and ketones can supply up to 90% of the body's energy needs. But where does the other 10% come from? Well, it comes from glucose. Yes, the burning of glucose is dramatically reduced because our bodies have significantly increased fat burning and introduced ketones as a new fuel source. It's important to remember that just because somebody isn't consuming carbohydrates doesn't mean there isn't any glucose in our bodies. Even when we're well adapted to burning fat and ketones as fuel, which can take weeks to months, we don't eliminate glucose as a fuel source altogether. Some cell types are dependent on glucose for fuel because they lack mitochondria. And whilst the brain can use ketones for most of its energy, it may still have some requirement for glucose. And this begs the question, where does this glucose come from if we're not eating carbohydrates? Well, it comes from a process called gluconeogenesis, which is a long and complex word that means make new glucose. Both fats and protein can be broken down into glucose by the liver, so even though some tissues require glucose, this need can be met by gluconeogenesis rather than carbohydrate consumption. Even in severe starvation, blood glucose levels are sustained at the lower end of the normal level. So no, we don't need carbohydrates for energy. Our bodies can cope remarkably well without them, even under the stress of significant exercise. I see a few other arguments as to why carbs are essential. Do we need carbs for thyroid function? The blood level of active thyroid hormone T3 will typically fall between 30 and 40% in the first few weeks when carbohydrates are restricted. So you can understand why some say cutting carbs causes thyroid issues. But this reduction in hormone levels isn't accompanied by any of the signs or symptoms you'd expect from someone suffering from low thyroid levels. What is happening is there is an improvement in the sensitivity of our tissues to the thyroid hormones. This is a healthy response and not an illness. So no, we don't need carbs for thyroid function. Do we need fiber for bowel function and gut health? If carbs are non-essential and fiber is a form of carbohydrate, then fiber is non-essential, right? Yes, you won't get any deficiency from not eating fiber. Now, fiber is controversial and many people regard fiber as healthy. But is there really any high-quality evidence to support that? There is evidence that high-fiber diets are harmful to some people. This month, a paper published in Nature showed a high-fiber diet makes rheumatoid arthritis worse. I'm not going to get into the debate over whether fiber is or isn't a good thing in this video, but I recommend you watch an excellent video by Dr. Zoe Harkham, which dives into this topic in depth. I'll link to that up here and in the description, along with some other interesting articles about fiber and ketosis. What I'd say about fiber is that at best it falls into the category of desirable for optimum health rather than essential. Do we need carbs for the other nutrients that carbs contain? One of the common arguments for consuming carbohydrates is that we need the other nutrients that go along with carbohydrates, particularly in plant-based foods. There are numerous health-promoting compounds called phytochemicals that can be found in plant-based foods, as well as vitamins and minerals. You'll find many strong arguments to suggest that we should consume plant-based foods for this reason. But there is also the argument that there is a lot of bad stuff in plant foods. Plants, after all, have natural defenses to stop them from being eaten or prevent diseases. They haven't got the luxury of running away as animals can. They produce proteins such as lectins to stop these attacks, and we've been selectively breeding plants to become more disease resistant and have been increasing the concentration of these proteins. If you've previously been under the impression that because it's plant-based, it's always good, then I recommend you check out a fantastic talk about lectins by Dr. Paul Mason, which may change your mind, and I'll link to that up here. So hopefully we've cleared up the confusion. There's no inherent need for the body to consume carbohydrates. So you don't need to be worried about missing out on anything for this reason if you're considering starting a low-carb diet. And remember, unless you're considering an exclusively carnivorous diet, you'll still consume some carbohydrates. Even a strict ketogenic low-carb diet still contains some carbohydrates. And one of the most popular videos on my channel talks you through the 16 best low-carb vegetables to eat on a low-carb diet, which you might like to watch next. And I'll leave a link to that on the screen. Thank you for watching. Please give this video a thumbs up if you found it helpful. Please share it with a friend who might find it interesting. And make sure you're subscribed to my channel so that you can catch all of my new videos. Hopefully, I'll see you in the next one.